In the 1970s, punks had tried to shake the rock establishment from what they saw as its apathy.
If I get the feeling you've been cheated.
By the beginning of the 80s, mainstream rock and roll was bigger than ever, filling arenas the world over with classic rock sounds and heavy metal power. Much black music, too, had become more stadium-oriented, built around lavish, expensive productions.
Oh, don't make me do that! Oh, I don't want to dance!
But there were new, sparse sounds coming from the mean streets of the Bronx. Rappers and DJs armed only with turntables and microphones were creating a powerful new music. And in urban dance clubs, computers and cutting-edge electronics made the DJ the star of the show, changing the rules as rock and roll entered the 1990s.
Looking for the perfect beat, searching for the perfect beat, looking for the perfect beat, seeking for the perfect beat. I must get mine, I'm about to get it, I must get mine, I'm about to get it. Now in this world of music, there are many different tones. Tell them, if there's no satisfaction, just take for some action. Listen up, listen up.
Who the hell are you?
We're the band.
The band? Where's your instruments? What the?
In 1983, a trio of young, upper-middle-class white kids from New York City began adding rap tunes to their hardcore punk repertoire. They called themselves the Beastie Boys, and by 1987 had become the prime movers in popularizing the hip-hop sound for white adolescent America.
When we first came out making hip-hop, people were just like mainly surprised because no white kids were really up on hip-hop or doing it too much. So like, I guess a lot of kids would just check it out and just be surprised to even hear that we were making that kind of music and just be like, what, you guys are white? Like they would think we were Puerto Rican or something, or just not figure that we were white. Kick it!
I first met the Beastie Boys actually at Negril, just hanging out, because we were all punk rock people who really loved rap music.
Rick definitely came from like a whole AC/DC, like Led Zeppelin, Long Island, like rock background. He pretty much, I guess, in that sense, kind of introduced us, because we kind of came from like punk rock, like, all right, forget about that shit, you know. We just wanted to, you know, do hip hop, and he kind of definitely brought that kind of in a big way. I mean, definitely we got real into it and got into the idea of like Led Zeppelin having beats, or, you know, AC/DC having grooves and beats, whatever.
They came by my office. They had on red sweatsuits and do-rags. I was like, and red Pumas or something, I think, I don't know. It's like shock, because that's not the way it looked in Dance Interior. You know, the image was, we're rappers, don't we look like them?
But you're right.
And I saw them perform, and they looked like themselves, and they were on stage. I said, why can't you be the Beastie Boys and be that? And they did. They started not giving a fuck, like their clothes and attitude, too, because that's all they were anyway, is kids who didn't give a fuck.
Their first album, Licensed to Ill, sold 4 million copies, reaching number one on the pop chart, number two on the black music chart, and earning praise from critics. Three Jerks Make a Masterpiece headlined the Village Voice. The Beasties played up their obnoxious image and became a kind of worldwide scourge, like the Sex Pistols had been 10 years earlier.
We read Hammer of the Gods and thought that was funny. Thought, yeah, we could do that. We could smash a TV. That'll be sick.
Yeah, or definitely, like, during the time that we were making License to Light, if you remember, like, we would be going out to clubs like Desateria or whatever with, like, Rick and Russell every night, and to us it was just really funny at the time to kind of be, it was, like, almost making fun or, you know, doing a parody on, like, that kind of culture, like, oh, wouldn't it be funny if we act like this, and then at a certain point we actually started to act like that.
It's funny, when the Beastie Boys got popular, people were saying to me, oh, you know, they're so obnoxious, and it's like, well, it had nothing to do with them becoming successful. They were obnoxious from the moment I met them.
If the Beastie Boys seemed self-absorbed and bratty on their records, their live show removed all doubt. They were three teenage libidos run rampant.
Well, we're performers, you know, first, foremost, entertainers.
Just like MC Hammer.
And the show, and the show is first. It's the utmost for us.
People were really freaked out that all of a sudden, number one, we are having concerts where there were black groups and white groups performing on stage. You have black kids and white kids coming together in a way that they probably never would have for any other group at the time. And then, you know, all of a sudden we were like kind of in the heart of this like kind of Bible Belt conservative
and these kids
part of the country.
Saying the worst things with their foul mouths.
These mad, nutty kids. So, you know, we kind of definitely freaked people out at that point.
And that was when the PMRC was really cool, when they were like right at their strongest peak. 1987, PMRC.
The Parents Music Research Center was formed as a direct response to the increasingly explicit lyrics of rock and rap.
There is a new element of vulgarity, violence, and brutality to women that is unprecedented. While a few outrageous recordings have always existed in the past, the proliferation of songs glorifying rape, sadomasochism, incest, the occult, and suicide by a growing number of bands illustrates this escalating trend that is alarming.
We are asking the recording industry to voluntarily assist parents who are concerned by placing a warning label on music products inappropriate for younger children due to explicit sexual or violent lyrics. We now propose one generic warning label to inform consumers in the marketplace about lyric content.
I don't, a lot of it was actually just kind of alienating because really it went so far beyond what even our wildest fantasies ever were of how we could possibly be portrayed or whatever. You know, I mean, so much of, like, say, with the British tabloids went so beyond fact and so far into fiction in terms of, like, you know, me with a little bag of whips.
That was true. Now stay tuned!
We happened to come along at the right time of bringing hip-hop to a large number of people that maybe wouldn't have gotten it right then. But if we hadn't come along, there's no question in my mind somebody else would have, or another chain of events would have happened. Hip-hop music or rap music would have reached all those people eventually anyway.